Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and by other public television stations.
This is the second hour devoted to an examination of the volume The United States in the 1980s, the seminal contribution to an understanding of international and domestic problems issued by the Hoover Institution. Last week we examined aspects of our foreign policy. Today, with three contributors to the volume, including the editor of the domestic issues section, we look at ourselves and at our own economy. Martin Anderson was an economic consultant to President Nixon and subsequently to Ronald Reagan. His doctorate is in business administration from MIT, having graduated summa cum laude from Dartmouth. He is the author of The Federal Bulldozer, A Critical Analysis of Urban Renewal, and Welfare, The Political Economy of Welfare Reform in the United States. Rita Ricardo-Campbell has specialized in the economics of health care programs since taking her PhD from Harvard in economics. She has been associated with several academic institutions and served in numerous capacities with government. Before joining the Hoover Institution, she is the author of several studies, including economics of health and public policy. Alvin Rabushka, one of the editors of The United States in the 80s, studied at the University of Hong Kong and of Hawaii and took his doctorate at Washington University. He has been associated with various universities, American and foreign, until attaching himself to the University of Rochester in 1973, which he left in 1976 to join the Hoover Institution. His first book is called Politics in Plural Societies, A Theory of Democratic Instability. His latest book, coming soon, is called Old Folks at Home. I should like to begin by asking Dr. Anderson to explain what he means by, quote, reaffirming the needy-only philosophical approach to welfare, and what specifically he has in mind.
In the essay that I did in the book, I was referring to there seem to be three basic approaches to handling welfare in the United States today. One is what I have called the needy-only approach, which I think is shared by most Americans, which is that people who are, for some reason, unable to take care of themselves are eligible to some form of government aid. There's another approach shared by a relatively small number of people, what I call the private approach, which maintains that people really have an obligation to care for themselves, that nothing wrong with helping people, but being needy in and of itself does not incur an obligation on the part of other people.
Is this?
And there's one very important third one, which is again shared by a very small number of people, but who are very influential in what they can do, which is the guaranteed income approach, which basically says that everyone has a right to a certain amount of income simply by virtue of the fact that he or she exists.
Now, the principal sponsor at a time when both you and Patrick Moynihan were working for President Nixon of the Family Assistance Program was Senator Moynihan.
That's right.
And in recent times, about a year ago, shortly before you went to press, he disavowed his own sponsorship on the basis of studies which seemed to indicate that the guaranteed annual income or the negative income approach did not, in fact, furnish the stimuli which had been predicted. Can we safely conclude from your work in this book and from that of your colleagues that there has been an empirical disavowal of that approach to welfare by the conservative community or the non-statist community?
I think it's fair to say that all the empirical studies of the effects of welfare show conclusively that any form of a guaranteed income causes people to work less. And in fact, it's had some rather dramatic, unexpected effects. And I think the primary reason why Pat Moynihan became disillusioned with the guaranteed income approach was not so much the incentive to work, but in some of the studies that came out of the guaranteed income experiments, that showed a dramatic increase in the breakup of families. In retrospect, some people say, well, we should have expected that. There are a lot of poor people that are married, and they stay married because economically they have to be, and you give them the opportunity of 3 to 5 years with fairly good level of income, and a lot of the women took the opportunity and walked out.
Now, why do you conclude that it is impossible to have money incentives? You say that as a political matter, you can never so regulate the tax structure as significantly to enhance the incentive to work.
Yeah, one of the things about any kind of a massive welfare reform project is that you got to recognize there are three key elements, and they're all tied together. One is the average level of welfare benefits that people receive. Two is what they call the effective marginal rate of taxation. In other words, as people begin to work, welfare benefits are cut back and has the same effect as a tax rate. And third is the overall cost. All three are inextricably linked together. You cannot separate them. And in fact, you can build a nice mathematical model or show the relationship. If you begin to do something like, say, let us give people a strong incentive to work, let us not tax them more than, say, 20%, you automatically either sharply reduce the average level of payments or balloon the costs into tens and tens of billions of dollars a year. Now, for the last 10 or 15 years, a number of people who have been very sincerely motivated, they want a guaranteed income, have been referring to the solution of this problem as difficult. The solution is not difficult. It's impossible. And I think there's general agreement with that now.
Well, your effort to distinguish between the needy only and people at large ceases, however, when you arrive at Social Security, if I understand your essay. There, you are prepared to live with Social Security as an instrument, the proceeds of which go to anyone irrespective of need.
I don't mean to infer by the book on welfare reform that I'm prepared to live with any government program. Let me just say this. That particular book and that particular section dealt with one specific aspect of a guaranteed income in a welfare reform program. Now, in terms of the general government programs and the economy, that's a much larger question. So you shouldn't infer that from the essay. Social Security happens to be working in a fashion which it could be something that could be changed. It's not high on my personal priority list right now.
This is an area in which I've written a book called Social Security Promise and Reality, and it is high on my priority list because I think in 1981 or 1980 you will have to have legislation because the 1977 amendments did not solve the problem.
You mean the indexation amendments or the repeal of indexation?
That was part of it, but the problem is not solved at all because there will be, by the end of this coming year, only $8 billion left in the trust funds for the OASI, or the survivors and the insurance part of it, so-called insurance. And therefore, either the taxes will have to go up considerably, and they're scheduled to go up by 0.5% per employee, employer, so there will be a great many people upset when their paychecks are much smaller next January than were this January when only the base went up and not the rate.
Well, you're suggested, now here I may have your chapter confused with Martin Anderson's, but one of you suggested that the only appropriate solution is to increase the age at which these benefits...
If I can plug the book for a minute, we have a specific essay on Social Security by Professor Michael Boskin, who's one of these young time economists of the year. And he has a chapter devoted to the problem of Social Security. And he does suggest gradually considering raising this age from 65 to 68 simply because longevity has grown so much more. People don't die as young as they used to 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago.
And is it politically impossible to arrange a reversal of that curve?
I think it's Boskin's hope to stimulate thinking now and lay the groundwork over the coming years for people to live up to the realities of aging as well as the realities of funding and perhaps a shrinking government. Right now, I wouldn't bet that it would pass, particularly in an election year.
Michael and I don't agree on the solution. We agree on the fact that benefits should be reduced as well as looking at the tax side. My proposal, which is in my book, and I wrote on health, you're right, in this volume, I couldn't write them both. is to phase out spouses' benefits over a 30-year period for the retired and over a 50-year period for surviving spouses, and at the same time to give 2 years of credit, earnings credit, for each of the first two children born to women. Because I think I chaired the subcommittee on men and women under the Advisory Council on Social Security in 75, and listened to a lot of women who quite correctly wanted some credit. If you're working and married, you get either or benefit, you don't get both. And the one thing that women do contribute to society, which is different than what men do, is bearing children. And the 1977 amendments permitted, after 10 years of marriage, a spouse to collect on a primary benefit. Well, the rate of divorces in the United States, you could have 3 secondaries and 1 primary. And this, I think, is very bad and makes more viable my proposal on phasing out the spouse's benefits. Also, since that date, the Supreme Court has cleanly ruled that men and women are entitled equally to a Social Security benefit, and you don't have to prove need. And if that's the case, we're going to have a great expansion of benefits for several reasons, but that's part of it.
And the expansion of those benefits would do what to the corporate finances of the government? That is to say, by what percentage would that increase the obligations of government?
Well, I don't know precisely what percentage of the total government obligations. I do know on the trust funds,
of the
Social Security trust fund, if you have only $8 billion left after the end of 1980 in the trust fund, and that it pays out at a rate of $40 billion monthly, this is a very precarious position. And you don't have to have a great expansion to get us an even more precarious position. What we are hoping, of course, I presume if I were involved in it, is that the employment expansion will continue, at least in California it has. Therefore, payrolls are higher. Therefore, the tax rate on the payroll base revenue yield is considerable. And this is the part that's been saving it. The other thing that saves the fund is the increase in the number of women who are married and work. And as long as that keeps on continuing, but I don't think it can continue much beyond the percentage we're at, then you get an increase in revenues because you tax their wages, but at the same time they are entitled only to their own benefit based on their earnings or one half that of their husbands upon retirement. So that has bolstered the fund for years.
You wanted to comment.
I just want to make one point about it. I think one of the most extraordinary things about the Social Security program is that the people who pass the program and the people who are administering the program have seen fit to exempt themselves from it. And they have set up their own retirement pension fund. And maybe they know something the rest of us don't.
Well, there has been an oscillation of sentiment by what I call the non-statist community, having to do with whether welfare should be paid out in the form of cash or in the form of kind. The objective, obviously, is to look after people who are needy, who can't look after themselves. Is it your conclusion, especially in respect of health care, that one is always better off delivering in kind rather than in cash?
I don't think we're better off than... I assume you mean the government delivering in kind or in cash?
Is somebody better off receiving money with which to pay a doctor or receiving the doctor's services? Better off receiving money with which to buy goods or receiving food stamps?
Well, of course, the government now pays about 40% of the personal health care bill. And I am not in favor of any expansion of the government's role in that area. If they are to receive it in kind, as you suggest, Medicaid, I guess, which is for the poor and serves about 24 million people in the United States today, is closest to the programs of that nature. The But it isn't direct provision of medical care. They pay the bill to the provider, the physician, or the hospital. And they pay at below the rate on a cost reimbursement basis, which is charged to other people. That is, in the state of California, hospitals are receiving under Medi-Cal, which is California's form of Medicaid, only 60% of the costs, and so computed by the hospital. I don't say their accounting system is the world's best, but that is true. And Medicare, which is for the aged, is the other large government program, that is reimbursing much closer to total cost. But then physicians on the other side don't have to accept a Medicaid patient. This is a very complicated area. If a physician decides he doesn't get enough money under the government reimbursement, and he says, I won't take a patient who is paid for by the government, then that means you get, in a sense, two streams of medical care within a country. Under Medicare, the physician takes most of the patients, and then he charges more than what the government will reimburse him for. Many physicians do this. Actually, in the United States, we don't have direct provision in kind of medical care services as in the UK.
Mr. Rabushka, you lay great stress in one of your points on user fees. Is there a sense in which that philosophical principle impinges on the discussion so far?
I was going to answer a bit of that question you raised earlier also. I think a large number of studies show that cash transfers rather than in-kind tend to be more efficient, largely because people spend them on goods they value rather than being forced to consume goods they don't value.
Like booze?
Well, like booze, like housing, like a number of goods and services. But your remark raises precisely a reason why we tend to give them largely in kind rather than in cash, because how do you politically respond to an answer? Booze. It's not a very easy thing to say that you want to help people, but as a price of helping them, that is you, the taxpayer, need to be willing to let them be free. That is, that you're helping them does not tie them to your preferences, your desired basket of goods you want to have.
So that they can allocate whatever surplus they have in any way they want.
That's right. You will create a substitution effect, an economic phenomenon, and you may indeed end up encouraging people to take money they might have otherwise used in that way and use it for things like travel or extra clothing or what. But I don't think there's anything you can do about that. The question is that if you're determined to help them, if the political system has resolved through its majoritarian institutions to do that, what's the most humane and free and efficient way to do it? And I think the growing consensus is it meets all three of those requirements more effectively in cash rather than in kind. But turning to user fees, it's a philosophical approach which I think is attested to by people of all political persuasions. It's the fundamental view that you get what you pay for, or there's no such thing as a free lunch. Now, you and I would demand unlimited quantities of government services that we like if we don't have to pay for them. But if I charge you directly for a municipal swimming pool, in principle, it's no different than charging you for entrance to a Broadway play, a bowling alley, or a movie. It's a similar kind of entertainment activity, yet we seem to have decided to charge one to the general taxpayer and charge others to people's private income. I think a shift in the movement of user fees does a number of things. It explicitly relates cost to benefits, so you don't have people demanding goods they don't have to pay for, in which case they demand more.
Or think they're not paying.
Or think they're not paying directly. You may pay for it, Mr. Buckley, but I get it free. Mm-hmm. This way I have to pay for what I want. And I think in some ways it requires the government to tailor its services, when the government provides these services, to the consumer, rather than decide what the services will be, whether the consumers want them or not.
We had here not long ago someone who was ardently defending the notion of a free public library, and the issue, of course, arose. In fact, most public libraries could be sustained by paying 5 or 10 cents per book acquisition, which is not inconsistent with the order in which people pay for things, as you say, movies or bowling alleys or whatever. Would would your user fee principle extend to public libraries?
Oh, absolutely. Proposition 13 in California is a good opportunity to study lots of things. It's a good laboratory. We've had it. We've had GAN's Spirit of 13 Amendment. We're facing now Jarvis II, which would cut the tax rates in half. So we've had a succession of fiscal restraints, limitations, restrictions. One of the areas that got substantial press coverage was libraries. And the argument was that we would have to cut back in libraries because it was not a, quote, essential service. And so we would close branch libraries, we would reduce hours, we would make it more difficult. And the media indicated this would impose great inconvenience and hardship on people. Well, I haven't seen any systematic evidence that use of the library has fallen. If anything, as I've looked casually around Northern California, it seems absolutely no different than it was before.
Are they still free?
They are still largely free, that is correct. That is, they have been able to provide the same amount of services, if by that we define books checked out per capita or some other quantitative measure as before, on a smaller budget with fewer staff and fewer hours. One benefit, for example, is you automate. You use less labor. I think you can respond here, but I have no reservation at all also about charging for a service what it costs. And I see no reason why users of libraries shouldn't pay to use them.
Let me ask you this, and perhaps you'll all want to comment on it. The paradox has frequently been observed that what one might call the economizers, people who want to buttress the private sector and reduce the public sector, are working at cross purposes by a series of constitutional provisions in individual states that make politically likelier that the federal unit is going to have to take on functions previously taken on by the states. How do you handle that problem?
I've heard that argument. I've heard the argument locally that restricting local communities will require more centralized control in the state capital. Similarly, restricting the states requires more, and I'm sure if we had a world government, we would say restricting Uncle Sam would require more world financial activity. Obviously, there's several answers to that question, one of which is to do something at the federal level, where with the power to print money, they don't quite have the constraints the states have to escape their balanced budget requirements. And there is a good deal of activity in this area. As you know, the National Tax Limitation Committee has a spending limit out. The National Taxpayers Union has worked with 30 state legislatures thus far, so we're four state legislatures from a possible constitutional convention to balance the budget. The Senate itself and the House have numerous resolutions calling for variations of tax spending limits, balanced budgets, and I think there's growing recognition, and many of the provisions say that if there should be some kind of federal mandate on the state, federal government's got to live within its budget. Similarly, in California, it says that if the state mandates a local expenditure, the state's got to pay for that, and that's got to come out of the state share. But be that as it may, I think it's important in many ways to check what has been, for the last 50 years, an unalterable rise in the level and scope of government spending and control from 10% of our GNP 50 years ago to better than one-third today. And it's easier, of course, to attack this at the local level through initiative and referendum. It's harder at the national level, but I don't think the prospect of a problem down the road should paralyze you into inaction where you can indeed act to have some effective control over government where you live, at home.
In other words, let the individual states, if necessary, lead the federal states in the proper direction. If you mobilize the individual states in the direction of the economy and a growth of the private sector, you will have a spillover effect on the mood in Congress for so long as the people can be shown that federal expenses are simply another form of local expenses.
Well, we are a federal system of government with shared responsibilities and joint responsibilities. And it allows us to do some things which other Western countries cannot do by virtue of having unitary systems of government. It lets you take California and, as it were, view it as a living laboratory, compare it with movements and legislation and initiatives in other states, see the consequences, and hopefully we can learn from this competition of ways of trying to address these problems, which methods may be most appropriate for other states and at the national level. But I concur with that sentiment.
You have some pretty impressive figures on the actual workings of Proposition 13, on which you touched a moment ago in your references to the public libraries. But what about unemployment and the predicted?
I'm glad you asked that question. I just picked up on the airplane before coming out the annual report of the state's Department of Employment Development. The way to best appreciate those numbers is to tell you that several months before the election, the forecasts that were most used in the campaign against Proposition 13 promised 450,000 lost jobs, widespread disruption in local services, a rise in the unemployment rate from 8% to 10%, and the attendant chaos it would produce. 1978 witnessed nearly 500,000 new jobs. 1979 witnessed 377,000 new jobs. So the forecast went from a negative 450 to a positive 600 since the enactment.
And unemployment.
The unemployment fell, believe it or not, to 6%. And the historic 1 percentage point gap between California and the rest of the country fell to where it's equal. Our personal income in California rose 12.9% last year. We were one of the few states in the nation to virtually keep up with inflation. And the list of achievements goes on. We did, I'll be fair, lose 17,000 public sector jobs, of which at least half were part-time in the schools, largely maintenance people. And we did lose some of our free, I mean taxpayer-supported, summer schools, which many believe ought to have been borne by the parents of those children.
So this economic turnaround wasn't the result of the inspiration of Governor Brown's leadership?
I would say that Governor Brown pulled the political coup of the decade by managing to persuade more people in the first public opinion poll following Proposition 13 that he more strongly supported it than his Republican opponent, Evel Younger, despite the fact that Brown was part and parcel, though not too vocal, but part and parcel of the opposition to 13. Within a day or two afterwards, he virtually claimed it as his own, and as you know, then went national with the Balance the Budget movement.
But I think you also ought to point out that the Republican contender was not very enthusiastic about Prop 13, and Brown did come out and simply say, well, folks, I changed my mind. I'm your governor. You want me to do it? I'll do it.
You approve that?
I recognize it.
That's good politics.
Now, in this volume on the 80s, you make some rather pessimistic projections based on a relative stagnation, which you see as a corollary of the increase in the size of the public sector. Do you carry those figures in your head about the growth of personal income during a period when the total of government expenses began with 12%?
Some of the numbers that I have looked through and acquired tell a very interesting story, and I think provide the backdrop to the tax revolt and Proposition 13 and the Balance the Budget movement. Between 1947 and 1973, which is really the immediate post-war period, real personal income doubled. It went up about 3% a year. Or in very loose terms, our standard of living as a people on average doubled. Well, during this period, the size of government was growing, but the rate of growth of the economy was sufficient not only for you and me to consume more, but for the government to do more. Now, between 1973 and 1979, it's not the same story. If you factor into the equation the addition in the labor force, real personal income, that is, taking into account inflation and the size of the workforce, actually fell slightly during this period. But government didn't fall, which meant the government is spending more and people are spending less. Personal saving is at a record all-time low. Stock market in real terms reflects that, I think, and those prices are rather substantially low.
Be right with you. But what if you factor in the value of the government's expenditures insofar as they constitute relief to the individual for expenses he would otherwise have spent? Then how are we doing?
That's a very hard thing to calculate when you try to calculate redistribution. Costs and benefits are being borne unevenly, and you also have to take into account the disincentive effects. The higher taxes imposed on the productive sector of the population due to their incentive to work when you transfer income to those who are less productive. So you do tend to distort activity. I don't have the numbers or answers to that, but what I think it is fair to say is that the reason you could get a 2-to-1 vote for Prop 13 and a 3-to-1 vote for the spirit of 13, the state of Washington voting 68-32, and so on down the line in 78, 79, and likely again in 80, is that when real income is held constant or falls, people are much less willing to do good to others through many of these programs. And that unless the economy can revert to its track of real economic growth and a better life for all, we're likely to see this constant pressure held on government not to expand relative to the private sector.
Dr. Campbell, you had something on your mind.
Yes. The interesting part in this is the continued expansion of the growth of the health as a percentage of the gross national product. It's over 9% now and nearing 10, and the reason is that because of the third-party umbrella and the fact that the person who is purchasing at the time of the consumption of medical care is really not paying nowhere near the resource cost of what he is purchasing. In fact, he's getting a very great bargain, because if you try to compute the resource cost as a net, a comparison between it and the net price that you pay for health care, you find that the net price has fallen to the average person in recent years. So the best bargain you can get, since you're not really paying for it, is to buy health care. And so it's risen from originally, say, 7-8% at the beginning of the 70s. It's now at 9%, moving towards 10%.
But you are, in fact, really paying for it.
Out of taxes, maybe, depending on how your income pattern fits into the taxation pattern of the country. Mm-hmm. You may or may not.
Yeah. Let me just like to comment on this, the general question of whether it's the tone of pessimism or optimism in this volume. And my own personal view is that while there are very severe problems facing the United States right now, that what these essays show is that there are some very clear alternatives we can follow. There are steps we can take, and properly done, kind of a very dramatic effect on these problems. So that in terms
of... what are some of these, give your own priority?
Well, my priority has been changing, but I think the most severe problem we face right now is the problems you talked about in the first program, foreign affairs and defense, and that unless we solve those, we may not have any economic problem to solve. But assuming that that's solved or is resolved properly, for example, on the economic front, the economy is in terrible shape today, and inflation is, in one sense, ripping the society apart. But there are things that can be done. You can control some of the waste in government spending. You can lower the tax rates to stimulate productivity. You can reduce government regulation, which show in certain cases. In the area of energy, there are things that can be done. You can decontrol the price of energy. You can stimulate new production. You can dismantle the Department of Energy. A lot of nice, specific, concrete things you can do. And perhaps the most important thing we could do in economic policy is to maintain a constant policy, almost regardless of what it was, so that people who are investing, businessmen, can look forward to the future with a certain degree of confidence that the rules of the game won't change next week. This is just one area. and I think those things hold as you go across the board, and issue after issue. So I think that there is a reason for a great degree of optimism that these are not intractable problems. There's something we can do something about.
Now, the fact that we can do something about it in terms of changing the model is one thing, it was you who started talking about what was politically possible and what
Yes.
was politically not possible. Now, I read recently that research shows that the total income to the government from the income tax from the level of 37% on up is $5 billion, or less than we spend in 1 week. It would be, I think, difficult to maintain the position that if one stopped taxing at that level, the government would actually be out $5 billion, since there would be a release of energy and a better
Much
economic
more.
Allocation. Is it politically possible for anybody to advocate a 37% ceiling on income tax?
I think it is. We have an essay in here by Professor Danthrop Smith, who used to teach at Harvard and served in the Eisenhower Treasury. And He tells this marvelous story. In 1978, the Carter administration sent down a three-martini tax bill in which he wanted to, in fact, impose higher taxes. And he had, of course, a Democratic Congress to work with. And we came out with the 1978 Capital Gains Tax Reduction Act, which some regard as the most significant tax reduction in the last decade or last several decades. There was a consensus of opinion among Democrats and Republicans alike. Unfortunately, Steiger died not too long ago. He was a major person in that act. But I think there's growing consensus in the Capitol and in the administration that, in fact, when you raise taxes, you may reduce revenues. And if you lower taxes, you can actually raise revenues through the stimulative effect, the expansion of the economy. And Art Laffer, of course, gets a lot of credit for this point. But it long existed, the fundamental thesis that supply-side economics. Incentives count. And that if you reduce taxes, you can widen the total tax revenue by having lower rates on a broader economy. And I think the 1978 Democratic Congress rejection of the Carter tax increase bill, and in turn sending back a substantial tax reduction, suggests that it is possible to move in this direction of lowering the tax rate significantly without detriment to revenue.
Yeah. And one of the things that I think that's occurring, I guess another reason for optimism, is that people are actually changing their minds about these things. And maybe that's what one expects when things get really bad. People think about them, and they do change. And particularly in terms of economic policy, there are very, very few politicians today that are running on a platform of higher taxes, with the exception of maybe John Anderson and gasoline taxes.
Yeah, which is something else, again.
Special, that's he's doing
an ad hoc
purpose.
Situation. Right. Well, are you prepared, either jointly or severally, to endorse Milton Friedman's proposal? I first ran across it from Sumner Slichter 25 years ago.
Of
guaranteed
worked.
Purchasing power bonds, or rubber bonds, or index bonds, whatever you want to call them.
Let me say that I think that in terms of an economic policy, there are a lot of things that have been proposed, like that indexing surtax brackets, balancing the budget, constitutional limitation on federal spending, and on and on. And I think all of them are correct. They're all valid. They're all in the right direction. They're all important. But no one in himself is going to solve the problem in a major way. And what we need now is an economic program, a policy of all these actions taken in concert.
You mean a little bit of each?
No, a lot of each.
No.
A lot of each. as regards these individual proposed reforms, you don't have a favorite, but you do, don't you? You'd like to see a constitutional amendment. In fact, it's the most intricate amendment I ever read.
No, it isn't. In fact, I've read about 40 or 50 of them, and what I've tried to do is distill a consensus from them. I'm very sensitive to your remarks about the political feasibility of some of the ideas in this book. It's quite easy, I think, to sit back and dictate prudent and efficient mm-hmm. economic policy. It's quite another to persuade a majority in both houses of Congress and the president to adopt it, even if they agree with it. My own preference runs to a combination package, which would both require a balanced budget, though intended to be over a period of years, not rigidly tied year to year, as well as a spending or a taxing limit. And the reason I go for both of them in the package is twofold. We have two problems. One is the problem of deficit-fueled inflation. And you attack that by not allowing the government to print money to monetize deficits. The second is the problem of the growth of government, the size of government, government regulation. You attack that either by limiting taxes or spending.
Or sunset legislation, but
a meaningful one. But if you only do one, if you limit taxes or spending, well, you can still run deficits and you can still monetize debt and have inflation. And if you only balance the budget, well, you could, although I think politically hard now, raise taxes to increase the size of government. So in some ways, the two are a tandem. And I think, as Martin just suggested, I agree with his remark. There's a lot of things we've got to do. And the particular amendment I favor, and it's really, again, it's kind of a measure of economic efficiency. There's an amendment which has just come out of the Constitutional Subcommittee of the Senate Judiciary Committee, and I got a copy of it not too long ago. It is simpler than mine, but it's very similar. What they propose is to have a balanced budget, and then they propose to have a taxing limit which requires that excess tax collections as a share of GNP be returned if they rise year to year. In other words, we have this problem of inflation creep. Each year inflation goes up, we're thrown into higher tax brackets, and we pay a higher share of our income to the government. Well, the second section in this constitutional amendment is designed to stop that process and not allow government taxes to grow year to year as a share. So you do have a taxing limit, a balanced budget requirement. You blend the two together, you have an effective spending limit, which is what the spending limits proponents want. And I think that attacks two of the serious problems that confront us.
Let me just add one point to that. I think I agree with all the specific proposals we've talked about in economic policy, and I'd like to just suggest one other one. If we're going to have a constitutional amendment, perhaps we ought to consider a constitutional amendment with several parts to it. That's been done before. And one of the parts I think we ought to consider is a constitutional amendment which would prohibit wage and price controls. I think the possibility of a government suddenly imposing wage and price controls on the economy hangs over the head of anyone thinking about making any kind of business and investment decisions. And as long as that possibility exists and can be done fairly easily, I think we're going to have a problem with uncertainty in the economy.
This is a part of your economic bill of rights, right?
That could be part of it, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Do you go along with that, Ms. Campbell?
I'm thinking in the aspect of the health sector. I served in the Health Services Industry Committee in Phase 2 price control. It doesn't make any difference whether you do have price control or not in the health sector, because the utilization rate is an evasion or avoidance of it. Since all you have to do, the standing joke of the committee was that eventually physicians would charge for the handshake, because that's a diagnostic tool. You see, before price control, you didn't have separated out a post-surgical visit, for example. Now you have about 20 different types of physician visits, and you just keep on breaking it all out, and you can get around a cap on prices by breaking out different procedures.
I guess more evidence for a constitutional amendment to prohibit them.
To prohibit that
just
is much more difficult.
Further what is already
You see,
distorted.
The problem in price control, from my experience, is the only people who know how to be really effective on it are the industry. I don't care whether it's steel, and I've had some experience there, which is far afield from medicine.
Don't tell me you were on the steel committee also.
No, this was years and years ago, and I did some consulting work for a steel company on the other side. Okay. And what you find out is that the experts are the industry people. Therefore, you can't operate in the government controlled position without some consultation with experts. And the experts know how to get around it. Any intelligent expert can do this.
Which means that wage and price controls are discriminatory, in effect.
They're discriminatory.
They can catch up some people, but not others who have a greater economic mobility.
Yes, and
people
also
who are more adept at breaking the law.
Sure.
Also, the larger the corporation, the more it can hire expertise. Let's say it's easier.
Mm-hmm. Well, our examiners are from the editorial staff of National Review. Mr. Joe Sobrin is a graduate of East Michigan College and also a syndicated columnist. Mr. Sobrin.
Mr. Anderson, I hate to sound like Mr. Bumble, but somebody has to at some point. We've been talking about in-kind payments as opposed to cash payments. Now, in keeping with your urging that we increase efforts to eliminate fraud in welfare, and given the fact that, as you say, there's no practical way to identify welfare cheats, isn't making the form of welfare less attractive one way to discourage people from choosing it?
Yeah, let me say it's one way, but first of all, I don't believe I ever said that I thought it was impractical to detect welfare cheats. I don't recall saying that.
Excuse me. Because there's no practical way to identify welfare cheats. I may be misinterpreting.
That's not me. But anyway, let me just make one comment about the whole issue of welfare. There are all kinds of issues we can discuss on welfare. Should it be in kind, or should it be cash, or how do you go about detecting welfare cheats, and so on. And I think there's a much more fundamental way to get at that whole problem. And there are really two major issues in welfare reform. One has been the question of, should we have a guaranteed income? I think, fortunately, that one's been settled against it, at least for a while. Another major issue is that what is the proper level of government to take care of the welfare function? My own predisposition runs toward getting it down to the lowest level possible, from the federal level to the state level to the local level, and ultimately and eventually to private and individual initiative. And currently pending in the Congress is a very radical piece of legislation, co-sponsored by, of all people, Senator Schweiker, Senator Dole, and Russell Long, which would strip HEW of all authority and return it to the states for welfare. I think that this kind of a first step, if you could return welfare functions to the control of the states, and then perhaps to control of local communities, a lot of the things that are impossible to do today are very difficult. For example, the detection of cheating in welfare. Everyone agrees it's there in massive amounts. But sure, it's very difficult for some executive making $35,000 a year living in the Watergate in Washington, D.C. to find out where it is. This has got to be done at the local level, and until these people have the responsibility and authority, I don't think you're going to get there.
Joe, do you have another question, or Linda? Linda Bridges is a graduate of the University of Southern California. Ms. Bridges.
To the layman, it seems that one of the principal problems, Dr. Campbell, with health care provision nowadays is just that we've made so many advances in health care. There are so many things they can do nowadays, but they're also expensive, that whereas formerly somebody might die, say, after 6 months of a kidney disease, now it can care for that person can just continue. He can live perhaps nearly normally for a number of years, but it's extremely expensive. So I think that seems to be part of our problem with health care, leading certain people to propose an almost complete provision of in-kind service of the sort that you have in Great Britain, I believe, and in Scandinavia. Other people to propose catastrophic health insurance, insurance to prevent a family from being wiped out by a sudden serious illness. Where do you stand? Do you believe government should provide some sort of health care, and of which sort?
Let me speak 2 points to that. One is, I would like to point out that the only country in the world of the advanced countries that has been successful in controlling the percent of their gross national product going to health is the United Kingdom, and they've done it by putting a flat limit on it, and also by implying, that is, it's a 5%, which is far below Sweden, United States, Western Germany, Canada, any other country you can think of. They've done it by having not only a tremendous amount of waiting, but there are implied allocation regulations, because the waiting is so great for an appointment or for an operation. And one of the waiting or applied regulation is anybody who's 50 years or older, you think, it's almost impossible to have a kidney transplant or kidney dialysis, and that is a sentence of death to a person with terminal renal disease. I don't think Americans want to allocate health care in that fashion. Now, let me speak to the other part and where I would stand.
But don't they also reduce the level of income of medical practitioners having socialized the profession?
Yes, because they have only this part. Therefore, you run a risk of a strike, which of course they've had, and we've had a small one in California where we had an interesting example of the death rate falling when the surgeons were on strike. But
they had a big one in Saskatchewan, too.
Yes.
But it isn't a part of England's success in holding down costs.
No
capital. Simply smaller remuneration for practitioners.
That's true, but it's also partly because they don't deliver the same amount of medical care that we do, at least as far as I can see.
Limited access.
Waiting in the United States is beginning to take over allocation. If you look at surveys, it's no longer people saying, I don't have the money and I can't get an appointment. And I might point out that a gentleman in charge of the largest group HMO, Health Maintenance Organization in Washington, D.C., is on record, according to the Washington Post, of having said that we deliberately structure waiting or keep people waiting for an appointment to up to 12 weeks for specialist care, because otherwise the demand would so overwhelm us we couldn't provide it, which is an interesting statement. Now, if you go back to your question on catastrophic, I am in favor of a sliding income, that is, percentage of income above which a family would not have to, or an individual, spend on medical expenses, and a fairly high one. But I would not want to see it beyond that amount. I do think most people feel, and I very strongly feel, that the big mistake made in the United States is what's called first dollar coverage. That is, the trade unions fought very strongly for this. It is a fringe benefit, and you get the first dollar you pay out or very close to it covered, and it's never taxed either by the employer who expenses it. It's subsidized. That's why you get very high income going to physicians and very high percentage going to national health.
Yeah, General Motors pays more for medical insurance than for steel.
Yes, they paid over $1.3 billion this past year for health insurance premiums. It's interesting that the companies...
And there were no imputed benefits on the tax tables of the employees for that at all, right?
Right. And you see, it's better to get a dental insurance. For example, Stanford University dental insurance is now being given than to get a wage increase, because you don't pay tax on that premium.
Richard Brookhiser is a graduate of Yale University. Mr. Brookhiser.
Yes, Mr. Rabushka. Funny thing seems to be happening here as far as conservative economists' attitudes towards the people. I think it always used to be assumed that the larger the franchise and the more votes people could take on economic measures, the more goodies they would vote themselves and the worse and worse off we'd all be. And yet, Proposition 13 was a referendum measure, and as you pointed out, a lot of similar measures in the states have been initiatives and referendums, very democratic things. Is there an irony here?
Not an irony, but you couldn't have asked a better question. This is a very optimistic part of this book, incidentally. Proposition 13 was an overwhelming majority. Now, why was that? Well, up until now, explanations about the growth of government are couched in what's known as a concentrated benefit diffused cost theme. I'm going to lobby like blazes for a lobby against Mexican tomatoes, because as a California tomato producer, I really make a lot of money. But you only save 10 cents if you effectively destroy that tariff. So you're not going to invest terribly much effort in that, and you may not even know about it. But now let's take a look at Proposition 13. The average gain by the average homeowner is estimated to be $800. Okay? So it's never before happened in any election, to my knowledge, in this country that I or my co-citizens in California could walk into the ballot box, pick up the little needle, punch a hole, and walk out with the high prospect of $800. Now, what we've done here is have a complete inversion of the concentrated benefits diffused costs. We have the concentrated benefit to the majority here, or a diffuse benefit to this large majority, and the minority that lost, in effect, are those people who were the beneficiaries of the government in California. And I think you're likely to have, in a highly taxed middle-class society, more and more people who are worried about their tax liabilities than they are about cutbacks in government programs, especially when they believe, and I think in some cases, maybe many, quite rightly, that government is inefficient and could be cut back without cutting back real services.
Can I just one further question? That implies it was just an economic motive for voting for Prop 13. But if I recall the poll results, there are a lot of people who lived in apartments and who work for the state government who also voted for it. So I think there are people who are deciding for political reasons, more reasons, that certain things are not right and they're willing to change them. Is that right?
The polls do show that almost every category of the population, almost every category, had a majority in that subcategory vote for it. And this is different from the conventional political wisdom we have, which breaks political movements up by race, by income, and the like.
even the San Francisco policeman came on TV just ahead of it and said, we are for Proposition 13, although they had been told they would lose their jobs. They just didn't believe it.
But when asked why, they said they didn't believe what they had been told.
They didn't believe it. I agree with you.
Well, what percentage of Californians have a house?
You have a housing expert.
About two-thirds.
But then, and what about the benefits, or were there any, to people who rented apartments?
You know, this
did
is not...
Did they slow down?
The California rental market is a classical example of supply and demand, and the demand for housing in California in a no-growth environment has far outstripped supply. So what I am prepared to say, I think with some confidence, is that in the absence of Proposition 13, rents would nominally be higher than they are today. So that the opportunity cost of not having Proposition 13 would have been higher rents. But you don't see a rent saving when the difference is between an increase in 20 and an increase in 40. I think people wanted to have their rents actually cut, but inflation each year would cut your rent if your rent remained the same in nominal terms.
Now, let me ask you, can you quote figures as optimistic as those that you have just finished quoting about the effects of Proposition 13 that apply to the capital gains reduction tax of 78? Or is it too early?
That's right.
I don't have the numbers on those. I think the people who more specifically focus on taxes might be able to treat that.
Yeah, let me say that there's a lot of evidence in the past in the United States and in many other countries where you've had a situation with high effective marginal income tax rates, taxes on capital, that when these rates are reduced, there's a very powerful stimulative effect on the economy. I think there's a broad amount of evidence to support that.
The 1920s are one example. The Kennedy tax cuts in the 1960s are touted as another example. The cuts in California now and proposed are touted as a third example. So I think we could probably get these. If you were asking specifically about the 78 cut, I think it may be too early on that one.
Is there any evidence in the shift of economic resources in a more intelligent way, an economically more intelligent way? Or is that too early?
Well, anytime you remove restrictions to the free movement of capital, you, of course, improve efficiency. So there's no doubt that's happening. And the argument then becomes to somehow or other continue to remove these restrictions and regulations on the free movement of money.
Thank you, Mr. Rabushka, and thank you, Dr. Campbell, and thank you, Dr. Anderson, and authors of the United States in the 1980s, or rather contributors to it. And thank you, Ms. Bridges, Mr. Sobrin, Mr. Brookhiser, ladies and gentlemen.
Printed bound transcript of this program, send $1 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250. Indicate the subject of the program and please allow 3 weeks for delivery. This program was produced by SECA, which is solely responsible for its content. Funding was provided by this station and by other public television stations.